Hello, this is Vic. Welcome to my channel and thank you for viewing my videos. Today I'm in the beautiful country of Greece and I'm visiting the historic island of Salamina here in the Saronic Gulf of Greece. I'm not far from Athens. Salamina is the closest island to the capital city of Greece, the city of Athens. Athens actually is about 12 kilometers directly east from where I am right now. In this particular documentary, we're going to do something very unique, something that has never done before. We're going to explore a German Nazi anti-aircraft location built here on the highest hill of Salamina to protect the naval station that was taken over by the Germans in 1941. So let's go for a tour of this very unique, very historic site. But before we do so, let's learn a couple of things, a couple of historical things that will help us understand what we are going to see. On October 28th of 1940, the Italian armies invaded Greece through the Albanian border. Within a couple of months and after a heroic resistance, the Greeks were able to push the Italian armies back through the Albanian border and almost dumped them into the Adriatic Sea. Now Hitler had to save Mussolini's disaster and he had to change his plans for Barbarossa. You see, he was ready to attack Russia in June of 1941, but before he had to do that, he had to come down to the Balkans to invade Serbia and to save Mussolini's armies here in Greece. And they delayed his plans, by the way. This is why he attacked Russia in September of 1941, and then we know what happened. Now the German armies eventually reached Greece in 1941, in April 1941, and they were no match to the Greek, to the exhausted Greek army. And in April 1941, they reached Athens. Now, they took over Salamina, which is very close to Athens, as I said to you, right away, and they took the main naval station of Greece, located here in Salamina, which has been located here, by the way, since the 1880s, and they made it the center of submarine operations for the Mediterranean. Now, after conquering Greece, the German Nazi armies assigned most of the Greek islands to the Italians for administration purposes. Of course, that was a very bitter pill for the Greeks to swallow because they had defeated the Italian armies to begin with. And if it was not for the Germans, the Italians would not have taken over any of the islands. Well, the Germans decided to take over the island of Salamina, not because it was so close to Athens and so close to Piraeus, but because it was such an important base for the submarines here in the Mediterranean. So the Germans, the units that were assigned to take over the naval station were German SS units, and that was one of the most bitter pills for the Salaminians to swallow because of the reprisals and the cruelty of the German Nazi that took over this beautiful island. Now, in order for the Germans to protect the naval station, they had to go to the highest point right above the naval station, which is the hill that you're going to see here, and to build a complex of buildings and also to place anti-aircraft guns on the hill to protect it from the continuous and daily bombardment from the British bombers and fighters. And this is what we're going to do today. We're going to tour this complex of buildings and the other structures around the hill built by the Germans in 1941 as soon as they took over the naval station in order to protect the naval station and the submarines as they were coming and going through the narrow straits of Salamina. So let's go for a tour of this very, very historic place. Now, a quick warning and disclaimer. Nobody has attempted to explain the structure and the functionality of the buildings here the way I'm trying to do it. So if you have any suggestions, any ideas on anything that needs to be changed, or if you know otherwise, let me know via an email. Anything is more than welcome. Let's go to the tour. Let's start our tour of the site here in Salamina, this very, very historic site here in Salamina, by looking at the most prominent structure. And believe me, there are quite a few around. But let's visit the one that almost everybody knows here in Salamina. And that's because you have to drive by the structure in order to go up to the top of the hill. And this was the headquarters of the SS unit that was responsible for guarding this whole area here and for managing the anti-aircraft guns on the hill. Let's look at it a little carefully. Here's the car park or the parking lot, so the cars would drive up here with the officers. Here's the entrance to the complex. This is where the commanding officer would be, or officers would be located at their offices here. A very, very large room with three very large windows. There's a very good reason for the windows here, and there's a good reason why this building was built right at this site, at this place. And that's because in order for the British to attack the naval station, there were two directions. The northwestern direction, that way, between the mountains that you see on both sides, there's a flat area right there in the middle of the frame. So the planes had to come that way, or they had to come from the southwestern direction between the mountains, right there where the Bay of Salamina is located at. So here you had full view of what was going on. But in any case, here's the remaining two walls of the headquarters. You can imagine the Nazi officers standing here in the corner with maps and shouting orders as the British planes were coming to attack in order to damage the naval station and to hinder the submarine operations of the Germans. Now, the Greeks here have dug a corner here in the basement, possibly thinking they could find something. That's a very irresponsible move, because nobody knows what's under this building. And if there is anything, it will probably be unexploded ordnance. So let's look at the building a little more carefully. There are more rooms here. You can see the walls of the rooms. So here's a room which is about 7 meters by 3 meters in size. A very large room here, quite possibly sleeping quarters or more offices. Now here's something interesting. Whenever the British were attacking, the staff here had to go hide and cover themselves. And the steps here that you see right there lead to an air raid shelter in the basement of the building. You can miss these steps unless you look very, very carefully. So if you were to dig here, you would find a space below this whole structure here, a basement, which in reality would be the air raid shelter. Now look at these beautiful views on this beautiful summer day here in Salamina. This whole area here shows so many signs of tremendous destruction. When did the Greeks really blew up all these houses around here? There are so many. You have to look very carefully to find them, but there are quite a few buildings. We're going to look at most of them in the remaining part of the documentary. My estimate is at any point in time there were between 20 to 50 SS Nazi soldiers located here on top of the hill in order to man the anti-aircraft guns. But when did the Greeks really blew up and destroy all these buildings? When I was a child, they were telling us that they were destroyed by the resistance before the Germans left. That's highly unlikely. What happened is when the Germans departed in April of 1944, soon thereafter the Greeks came up here and blew everything up. It was a defiance act, actually. It was an act of resistance, but most likely it was an act to show how much they hated the Nazis for what they had done to their country. The Greeks were trying to erase these horrible memories of the German occupation. In 3 years they suffered tremendously, especially this island here, the island of Salamina. I mean, the locals, when I was a child, used to describe to us scenes of the Stukas attacking the naval station before the Germans took it, and then the British attacking it when the Germans took it over. So they went through two different wars, so to speak. So the Greeks had enough. They wanted to erase this from their memories once and for all. So the act of defiance was to come over here and just blow everything up and try to erase everything as if it didn't exist. Let's go back and look at the other buildings. In the distance, you can see the headquarters location that we just looked at. And just a few meters away, about 20 meters away, we find an intact water tank built by the Germans in order to serve the units here on the hill. Now, the water tank is important from one perspective. We need to look at the architecture, how the Germans built these buildings. This way, when we find buildings around the area, we can tell they are from the same era. You can see here the rocks used, local granite rocks and cement in between. There's no stucco covering the structure, just a little bit of cement. And what they have done here, they have drawn lines where the cement was placed at. And we find the same architecture all over the buildings. Let's go look at something very, very interesting now. Right there. And a few meters away from the headquarters location that we just looked at, we find this concrete platform here. And it takes a lot of experience to interpret and to figure out what this platform was used for. But let's look at this location, and that will give us a very accurate hint regarding its function. This platform is facing directly northwest. And right there in the middle of the frame, there's a flat area between the mountains to the left and to the right. And if the British had to attack the naval station, this would be the prime area that would enter, the aircraft would enter in order to attack the naval station right behind this hill. So the location of this platform is a very good example where a radar will be placed at. That's one of the hints, the location. And these are the steps. We're gonna go up to the platform, come on. And let's look at it. Now, what we see here, we don't see any walls. See, there are no walls around the perimeter of the platform. That's one hint. This is not a living quarters or a guard unit. What we see here in several parts of the platform, we see these places here. And here, you see these little spaces in the concrete, and that's because this platform had a wooden wall and roof around it. Why would they do that at this place here? Now, in order to recognize the significance or the function of an archaeological site, one must draw conclusions and lessons learned from other places around the world. A few months ago, I was in the island of Bora Bora in French Polynesia in the Pacific Ocean. And I have a whole video that shows the radar location that the Americans had installed in Bora Bora on top of a mountain in order to face an attack or to predict an attack or even to recognize there was an attack taking place by the Japanese. And it was exactly the same structure. It was a platform with no walls around it. And the walls that were installed around it were just wooden walls. And this is where the outpost, the listening outpost of the radar was located at. And this is exactly the same structure. The location is very, very important, of course, because the radar at the time was not spinning around. It didn't have a 360-degree function. It had to face towards one direction. So it faces here at the ideal direction that the British would have selected to attack the naval station at Salamina. And the size of the platform and also the way it's laid out, it's a perfect radar listening post. And the radar unit was somewhere around here, maybe next to the building. You can imagine the Nazi soldiers here sitting and listening and interpreting the data as it was coming in this primitive radar they had installed here. Let's continue. And here's the northern part of the radar complex here in Salamina. We're gonna go up these steps, and there's something absolutely magnificent here that I want to show you if we can get there. Now imagine now that the soldiers sitting here, the Nazis, were listening, and they have warned the anti-aircraft units around them that there's an attack coming up through that area right there. See, they couldn't come through that area. Look at the mountains. The plane had no time to descend once it went over that mountain in order to attack these buildings and the naval station behind us. They had to come through the northwestern direction right there, the flat area. But what would they do? The British knew this radar existed here, and this would be their very first target before they even hit the naval station. So the Nazis here would warn everybody in the unit here, the aircraft are coming, and then they would go down these steps. You can imagine them now, 5 or 10 of them just screaming orders in German. Let's be careful here. And look at this. The next thing they would do is they would go to their own air raid shelter dug into the hard rock right there. Now we need to be very careful. You see a hole there, a huge hole, half covered with dirt. Let's go down a little more and I will show you. So you can imagine how the Nazis running, going down the steps here that were existing and hiding under the thick rock here to protect themselves, as the British aircraft were flying right above them, maybe about 10 to 20 meters in there, just above them. Let's go look at the air raid shelter here. Come on. I'm now right at the opening of the air raid shelter. And it goes for about 10 meters straight ahead, and then it goes to the left. And I assure you, I have no desire to crawl in there. You can see a lot of rubbish thrown here by the Greeks over the years. The Greeks have also tried here unsuccessfully to cover it completely. But this is where they would go hide. Let's go a little closer. Look at this. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a German Nazi air raid shelter where the radar crews would come over and hide almost on a daily basis to get away from the British. And once the British airplanes would fly above them, they would run out and run back to their units. And only God knows what is in here to the left side of the air raid shelter. Well, we're not gonna find out in this trip. Let's go back and check out some more structures. Wow, that was incredible, wasn't it? It's not every day that you get a chance to see an original air raid shelter built by the Nazi Germans here in Greece. And that's because after 1944, something really was happening here in Greece. Something that was really happening in other German-occupied countries, such as Albania, Serbia, and other countries as well. A lot of people were dying because a lot of shells and ordnance were left all around the area here. In the early 1960s, actually in the late 1960s, I remember two young children of my age had discovered two shells left by the Germans not far from here. They tried to open the shells from the back in order to get the powder. Of course, the shells exploded as they were handling the shells, that there was nothing left of them. I remember going to the funeral, and it's one of the worst experiences and memories I have had in my life. So in the mid-1970s, the Greek government decided they had enough, and they decided to cover all the air raid shelters with concrete or rubble or whatever they could find. There were at least 10 air raid shelters all around the island here in Salamina. I remember going in some of them in the early 70s. When I came back in 1988, all the air raid shelters were covered completely. You cannot even see them anymore. But this one here has not been discovered yet. Whew, let's continue. Let's come back to the radar station here for a second, and let's look at the wall and the structure of the wall, the surrounding wall. We see here a very similar structure with that of the water tank, just to ensure that all these buildings belong to the same era and to the same design. They will give us assurance that all these buildings were part of the Nazi complex here in Salamina. We are now moving north of the headquarters location and north from the radar site that we just saw. And here's a structure which is, or which was definitely used as living quarters. And I will tell you why I think so. Now this site is facing the modern city of Salamina, so it's facing directly south. It is a very large platform here. You can see that it had walls. You can see a hint of a wall over here, and also the other areas are separated by walls. And this, without a doubt, was a living quarter arrangement. This small area here, because of the tile on the floor, was most likely a toilet. This was a bedroom, and this was a very large bedroom as well. So the commanding officer of the whole unit would rest and live here. The first building that you saw would be his headquarters when he was in uniform, when he was resting. This would be the place where he would be coming to. That's because he had a wonderful view over here, and we know this is a living quarter because of the arrangement of the tiles. Whereas the other buildings, like the radar station and the headquarters, had no tile on the floor, just concrete. This Nazi officer here lived in moderate luxury, so to speak. Here's another room. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the house of the Nazi officer in charge of the 20 to 50 people up here manning the guns. Absolutely incredible. Let's get a view from up here. Right there. Now I have said, and I'll say this once again, nobody has done the work I'm doing here today regarding this site. And the Greeks that live here have no idea what these buildings are all about. Here's a view from the corner over here of his house, of the officers' quarters. So as I said, this whole floor here of this building was laid with beautiful tile, and here's a small part of it. But you know, I'm holding a piece of Nazi German tile used on the floor of a Nazi officer here in Salamina in Greece. Now it is, it's quite thick actually. It's about an inch, 2.5 centimeters. And the top layer, if you can see it here, is light brown, and this is what was used in the bathroom and also in the other areas as well. There are a few tiles remaining here, and I'm holding a piece of history, not the greatest history in the world, mind you, but here it is. We are now going to move on to a much larger structure damaged from the explosions of 1944 by the Greeks here. We can see considerable damage and pieces of the building here, two large fragments and parts of the rock all over the place. We're gonna go up here and look at this building. Now let's do what we have done in the past. Let's look at the walls to make sure we're dealing with structures that were built during the same era. You see the same architecture, same marks on the walls here. Definitely same architecture, same designer, and so on. Now we're going to enter through a corner. Now this one was not used for sleeping quarters, definitely, and that's because of the low wall over here. The headquarters, the sleeping quarters we saw of the officer, are just next to it, that direction, about 10 meters away. So this one had a very big platform here, concrete, and it was surrounded by a wall which was about a meter in height on that side, a couple of meters on that side, and there was a design here on the wall. You can see it, an elevated part of the wall right there in the middle. This was most likely a club of some sort. This is where the soldiers would come to socialize, believe it or not. That's because they had a great view over here, once again, of the modern town of Salamina, but the beautiful bay of Salamina extending beyond the small hill with the two windmills. So if the enemy, if the radar location was indicating nothing was happening, and if you were not on duty, you were a Nazi German soldier, this is where you would come to. Now here we find a lot of evidence of tile on the floor as well. So there used to be a flat floor, if I can show you part of it, right here. You can see part of the tile right there. So this whole building, this whole complex here, which measures about 10 meters by 16, was laid by tile. Absolutely incredible. What a historic piece here in Salamina. And this is why I'm saying, after studying all these structures over the last few days in preparing for this documentary, I concluded there were at least 20 to 50 soldiers on this hill at any point in time. And another view of this same structure from a different angle. This is the wall looking directly south. You can see there was a small platform over here. You can see hints of the tiles here. Here's quite a few pieces of the tile, and the steps were right here. So you would come up the steps and proceed this way and go up to that complex that I just showed you. You can see the destruction here from the explosives. And here's something very, very interesting. Here's a platform, round, 6 meters in length. And this is where the anti aircraft guns were placed on. Now, there must have been at least six of these platforms around the hill here. This is the only one remaining, almost intact. And the position of this platform is very, very important. The guns are facing directly east, right there at the Bay of Salamis. And they can also face northeast towards that direction. So if any planes were attacking the naval station, they would have to enter the Bay of Salamis through that direction or from a northeastern direction as well. And these guns were very strategically placed. Now, we're not really sure how many of these platforms existed. There must have been at least four, quite possibly a maximum of six platforms. That would make this hill a deadly obstacle to overcome if you wanted to come here by plane and attack the naval station at Salamina. Now, nobody really realizes the significance of this platform here. A lot of people drive by, they miss the point or the historical significance of this one. And unfortunately, this is the only one that remains. There's another one that has been broken up into pieces from subsequent work done here on the hill from the Greeks. Look at it. Now, the morphology of the hill has changed drastically since the Germans left in 1944. It was actually completely altered in the 1980s when the water company here, the Greek water company, decided to build this ugly structure you see behind me. It's a processing plant, and it was built right on top of the hill, changing the whole morphology here. Not only they changed the morphology of the hill and enlarged the top of the hill, but they filled the area here full of rubble. That's why it's so difficult to find these buildings. So now I'm standing on the circular structure I showed you where the anti-aircraft gun was placed at. So let's assume now the British are attacking and there are so many men needed to handle the anti-aircraft guns. But what about the rest of the crews, the officers and so on? Where do they go? Well, you saw the air raid shelter next to the radar station. The people had to go hide very quickly. They only had 15 seconds to hide because the British aircraft were coming right on top of them from the far distance. It would take 50 seconds to get to the radar site. So they had to build an air raid shelter next to them. But what about the rest of the crews? What would they do? Well, right on top of the hill here, the Germans had dug a much bigger, a huge air raid shelter. Let's go look at it and let's see what remains of it. Come on. So here's this utterly ugly water processing plant built in the 1980s that changed the shape of the hill completely. I'm now standing on the original level where the hill used to be, and quite possibly at the edge of the hill. That direction is the northwestern direction. And right below the slope here of the hill is the radar complex. Right there you can see the platform. So the British are attacking. Of course, the radar has given them 1 to 2 minutes warning that an attack is coming up. Crews are running all over the place trying to handle the anti-aircraft guns. Where does everybody else go to? And the answer is here. Let's go down very carefully here. Make sure we don't fall down. This was the biggest air raid shelter here in the complex. It has been covered, as I mentioned to you, from the government in the 1970s and 80s. And they had dumped huge boulders, but it was dug by the Germans. this was the area of the steps over here. And right there where the boulders are used to be the entrance to the raid shelter. It doesn't exist anymore, but from the size of the hole here, of the opening, you could tell this was a far bigger air raid shelter than the one we saw right there by the radar station. And who knows what's in that air raid shelter. And I can guarantee you nobody will ever find out. Now let's go look at some other structures that are scattered around here, and I will explain to you what they are. Let's do it. Now another question that you're going to ask me, and I'm well prepared to answer it, is the following. Okay, the Germans here knew that the British were going to attack at any point in time during the day, especially with aircraft from Malta, most likely. So they were ready for it. They had the anti-aircraft guns, they had the radar station, they were waiting for the British. What about other forces around the hill? Would anybody really attack the hill and take it over, so to speak? How were the Germans prepared to face such an incident or such an event? Let me show you a couple of structures that will indicate to you what the Germans had done in order to guard this whole area around the hill. Let's go look at one or two, and I will explain to you what they are. And here's one of the structures I want to point out to you, and I will explain to you what this is in a second. And you can see that this one is facing towards northwestern direction as well. Now let's look at the structure of this destroyed building here. You can see how thick the roof was. It's about 35 centimeters in thickness. You can see the steel right there sticking out. So it was built to last, and it was built to protect the people inside, and also to protect them from bombardment from above. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is a pillbox. A pillbox. This is where 2 to 3 soldiers would be standing at inside with a machine gun, guarding this whole area here. You can see this one has been strategically located to have a full view of the slopes of the hill. Now the trees here have grown considerably since the 1940s, and they block the view, but when this was built here, you could have a full view for a couple of miles that direction and this direction as well. So this is a very rare pillbox, German Nazi pillbox in Greece. It takes a lot of experience to recognize the function of this structure here. Trust me, I'm not making mistakes too often. Absolutely incredible. And this is one of the structures that the Greeks blew up soon after the departure of the Germans. But you see how much effort the Germans have put. There's nothing temporary here. The Germans put a lot of effort to guard this hill. You don't build thick concrete structures like that in one day. You design them and you build them with care. German pillbox, what do you know? Now I promised to show you at least a couple of these pillboxes. Here's the second one. This is right below the round structure where the anti-aircraft guns were placed at. And this was guarding the southern approach to the hill. Here's the Bay of Salamis in the distance. We're looking directly south right now. So if the morphology of the hill had not changed over the years, we should have been able to find about 10 of them around, but only two exist. The other ones have been buried in the rubble here. Actually, you can see rubbish right next to it, dumped irresponsibly and illegally here on the hill. And this peel box is the same structure, same thickness, steel, same layout. And here's the top of the peel box. So you can see it was about 2 meters by 3 meters in size, actually 2 by 4, to be honest. So I could comfortably fit three Nazi soldiers inside with a machine gun. Now, you saw that shelter covered with these huge boulders. It was covered by the government in the 1980s to keep people from going inside and getting killed or getting hurt. There's another shelter not far from that one. Now, why are there so many shelters? And there's one explanation for this, really. If this whole site had 50 people and there was enough time, let's say a siren would be heard, and people had 1 to 2 minutes, it would be a single large shelter. However, as I showed to you, because of the distance when the aircraft were approaching, it would take 15 to 20 seconds to be right on top of the hill here to bombard it and to destroy it. So that's why they had built so many shelters. You had no time to run to a central shelter. So you would run, depending on which unit you were assigned to or which building you were at, you would run and hide to the shelter that was closest to you. So here's another shelter here in Salamina. This one is covered as well, but this is so obvious it was a shelter. Just check it out in case you have never seen one in your lives. Look at this one. As I said, depending on which unit you were assigned to and where you were at the moment, you would run over here to the shelter. What they have done here is they have dug steps. There used to be steps here on the rock. Actually, you can see them right there on the bottom. And here's another air raid shelter dug by the Germans sometime after 1941. And right there where the tree is, the green tree, used to be the entrance to the shelter. Nobody, of course, would venture down there and dig those trees up and walk into the shelter. But this one has not been covered by the government, most likely because nobody knew that existed. Also, there's an entrance from the pine tree down there. Either you would take the steps here, or a soldier would take the steps very quickly, go down and run towards the shelter, the entrance of the shelter, or they would run from the another entrance down there where the pine tree is. Let's go down there to the pine tree and get an entrance, get a view of how it felt to be a soldier and run these 20 yards before you hit the entrance and hide into safety in the rock. And here I am, the pine tree is right behind me, and this is the beginning of the ramp. They will take you down to the air raid shelter right there. So this would be dirt here, and soldiers, the Nazis, will be running towards the entrance of the shelter right there. Unfortunately, it has been covered with the bushes over the years, but you can see the opening here. You can see the ravine formed towards the entrance of the shelter in the distance, which is about 20 meters away. Absolutely incredible finding here in Salamina. And right there in the far distance is the port of Athens, the city of Piraeus or Piraeus, as it is called in modern Greek. The naval station is just about 4 kilometers northeast from where I'm right now, behind this small hill in the middle of the frame. And in 1998, the Greeks built here on top of the hill this absolutely beautiful church. most likely and quite possibly the most beautiful church here in the island of Salamina. This is to commemorate their freedom from the Germans. And this church is dedicated to Virgin Mary, the freedom provider, Panagia Eleftherotria. And look at this beautiful architecture here at this church, because it's right on top of the hill, can be seen from miles and miles away. And look how beautiful it is, the architecture and so on. Now, Virgin Mary has been given many names by the Greeks, and this one is dedicated to Virgin Mary, the freedom provider. Because according to the Greeks here, it was the Virgin Mary that kicked the Germans out and liberated Salamina and Greece from the Nazis once and for all. These are the beautiful gardens that you will see here at the church. Beautiful. Wow, we are back where we started at this point here in Salamina. Now, just a couple of quick points. In order to videotape this brief documentary, it took a lot of work and a lot of studying. I had to come here 3 days in a row in order to map the morphology of the hill and explore the different areas and try to understand their functions. And after I gained a very good understanding of the geography, morphology, the topology, and also the functionality of the rooms, I decided to make this documentary. The second point is nobody has really attempted to explain this area to the Salaminians or to the Greeks. This is the very first attempt, and I can tell you I have come very close to the mark of being very, very accurate. So any corrections on any of my assumptions or facts stated in this documentary, they are more than welcome. The third point, and the most important point of all, is that this documentary was filmed on August 16th of 2016 to commemorate the massacre of the Greek village of Komeno, K-O-M-M-E-N-O, the massacre of 317 Greek people that died in the hands of the Wehrmacht on August 16th of 1943, when a unit of Wehrmacht attacked a small village in northern Greece and massacred the kids, the babies, the women, and the elderly, because they thought they were hiding Greek resistance fighters in the village. Of course, no one was found, but the Germans proceeded into killing almost 80% of the population of the village. This is Vic. Thank you for joining me in this spectacular documentary, very historic. It was a great pleasure of mine completing it, all the way from Salamina here in Greece. Bye-bye.